Hi everybody, welcome to the virtual SIB Computational Biology Seminar Series. Today we have the pleasure to have Philipp Bucher from the Computational Cancer Genomics at EPFL. Philipp completed, studied first the molecular biology in Zurich and then he completed his PhD in computational biology in 89 at Weizmann Institute in Israel. Where he worked on comparative analysis of eukaryotic promoters, as well as on the development of computer algorithms to characterize nucleotide sequence patterns positionally correlated with biological sites. Then from 91 to 95, he worked as a postdoctoral fellow at Stanford University in the US on statistical analysis of protein sequences, and as well at ISREC back in Switzerland, developing sequence analysis algorithms. Then from 95 to 99, he became associate scientist also at ISREC, working on gene discovery and characterization of new protein domains. And then from 2000 to 2007, as a senior scientist, he moved to the more to the computational cancer genomic area. And since 2008, Philipp is a group leader at EPFL and at SIB. So his group is interested in gene regulation both in healthy and diseased cells. The group is currently pursuing two main research directions. One is on the epigenetic profile and the other one is on so-called ultra-conserved element to track the still largely enigmatic regulatory code of the human genome. Philipp's group is also involved in, as I said before, in developing new algorithms, computer softwares, and web services and databases that we help that will help the scientific community to extract knowledge and understanding from large volumes of genomic data. So today, Philipp will give us an overview on the bioinformatic resources that are developed by the eukaryotic promoter database team. Philipp, thank you again for accepting this invitation, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. So these are the resources I'm going to talk about. The oldest one is the eukaryotic database, which actually I initiated in the early 80s. It's essentially catalog of experimentally determined transcription start sites in eukaryotic species. There has been a major redesign of the database about 5 years ago due to new data trends. And so today, essentially, it's two databases. It's the old EPD database, which is a frozen collection, and it's EPD new, which is actively maintained and rapidly expanding. Then I'm going to talk about the signal search analysis, SSA server. This is a web interface to a collection of old programs which have been developed in parallel with EPD, which are in many ways tailored to the use with EPD. And essentially it's a collection for finding and discovering DNA motifs. Then I'm going to introduce the ChIP-seq command line tools and web server. These are new programs that we have developed in response to the advent of the ChIP-seq technology, which in my opinion revolutionized research on gene regulation. Then I'm going to say a few words on the MGA, the Mass Genome Annotation Data Repository, which is the data backend of all our servers. And finally, I will present one of the newer tools we developed, not these SSA dinosaurs, which have been developed in the 80s, which we made public under a server named PWOM, Position Weight Matrix Tools Server. So this is a packed program. I apologize in advance that I will not be able to explain all the details behind these resources. Now first, EPD, so this is just the home page. Now this is a brief history. It started maybe in 82 with a computer-readable collection of transcription start sites. I think one, and also the introduction of a kind of a new concept, that of a functional position set. What I would like to mention is that EPD has never been a collection of DNA sequences. It always has been a collection of sequence coordinates, references to sequence positions. And in that sense, EPD is a very early version of a genome custom track file. And sequence analysis has been performed by extracting on-the-fly sequences around reference positions. Then in 1986, we published the first paper on a eukaryotic promoter collection. And at the same time, the ENBL Nucleotide Sequence Data Library agreed to distribute an electronic version of EPD on the ENBL tapes. In 1997, we introduced a richer format and we set up the EPD web server. Starting about 2002, we used computational methods to define transcription start sites, initially from EST sequences, from full-length cDNA clones generated with the oligocapping technology. We called this in silico primer extension because in many ways it does the same as an in vitro primer extension experiment just in the computer. And then around 2005 to 2007, we interfaced the EPD web server with the accessory web servers, in particular the SSA web server and the ChipSec web server. And this made it possible to analyze promoter sets and subsets of promoters in terms of sequence motifs and in terms of histone modifications and other chromatin profiling features in a very interactive and user-friendly manner. Then, between 2008 and 2010, we created the mass genome annotation repository. Actually, we had a large collection of useful high-throughput genomics data on our servers, and at some point, we decided to organize this collection in a way that, in a computer-readable way, but also in a way that external users can download the data in a standardized format. And at that time, we also started to the conception of EPD new, a completely new database, a new schema, a new compilation procedures. In 2011, we published the first beta release of EPD new, and I would say in 2014, it has become a completely productive and expanding data resource. Now, just some essential point. So the promoter definition is essentially an experimentally mapped transcription start site or initiation site cluster. And one of the important assumptions is that a capped 5' end of a cytoplasmatic RNA corresponds to an initiation event and is basically never produced by an endonucleotic cleavage event. So this has been called into question, but as a general rule, with some minor exception, it still holds. So that's why we can use actually mRNA 5' end data to define transcription start sites. Now, so the primary data have been RNA sequencing data, nuclease protection data, primary extension data published in journal articles for the old EPD database, and for the new one, it's essentially high throughput sequencing-based mRNA 5' end mapping data, like CAGE or cDNAs obtained with oligocapping, also called TSS-seq. Now, in parallel, the contents of the old database was based on a critical interpretation of published results, mostly pictorial results, and never on published conclusions. And likewise for EPD new, the EPD new is based on an independent processing of public data from high throughput data. Now, the purpose and the targeted user community, so it's primarily a resource for researchers who would like to investigate promoter sequences, structure and function. It has been for some time used as a training and test set for developing and testing promoter prediction algorithm, when this was a fashionable discipline in computational biology. And it is also a resource for experimental researchers who just would like to know more about a particular promoter. So again, EPD new has basically two components. One is the transcription start site collection, and we try to be to offer the best one. And best is defined in terms of high enrichment in true promoters, in very accurate TSS mapping, and to a lesser extent also to by providing links to genes and to genome annotations. Now, and then the second part of EPD new is the EPD viewer. It enables users to look at a particular promoter in a genome browser window, and the goal is to provide a useful customized data selection. For instance, cage data are useful to look at the dispersion of transcription start sites, ChIP-seq data are useful for understanding promoters, and DNA methylation data. So to provide a customized view and also to display the high throughput data in the optimal manner, at the optimal level of resolution. And here the target users are rather wet lab biologists which are interested in specific genes and would like to know more about the chromatin state of the promoter of these genes. Now, some of the design principles. With EPD new, we aim at complete coverage of model organisms, and we also have the intention to process large volumes of genomics data. So that's why we opted for a light resource design, which is relatively cost effective in terms of maintenance. It is focused on a few model organisms. We also extended the promoter definition a little bit in that we took into account chromatin structure. For instance, a nucleosome-free region defined by MNA-seq data would be an indication that there is a promoter. It uses an automatic compilation pipeline for defining promoters from mass genome annotation data, mostly from cage data. And it uses automatic and manual quality control of input data and also of the final product. So we are not really looking at each individual promoter, but we look carefully at the input data to prevent the garbage in, garbage out syndrome. And we then also look at the promoters, whether they intuitively make sense in terms of chromatin feature. And we decided to provide a user which is entirely UCSC-based, again, motivated by cost effectiveness in terms of development and maintenance. So, and once again, I repeat, the procedures are different, but the principles are the same. We based EPD on an independent and critical evaluation of experimental data and journal articles. And again, for EPD new, we use quality control and independent processing of published data. So we take cage raw data. We are not importing already processed clusters or something similar. Just to give you an idea about the data which go in. So these are cage-stack distributions for two promoters. They are displayed at single base resolution. You see a narrow promoter where almost all initiation events happen at the single position. Note that we have, 80,000 cage stacks hitting exactly the same position. So there's really based on large volumes of data, and below you have a broad cluster. And so basically what the automatic compilation pipeline does in a simplified manner, it identifies these clusters which may have quite different shapes, and then selects a reference position and maps it to a plausible target shape. Now this is EPD new from the developer's perspective. The data come from public repositories such as GEO or Ensemble. Ensemble we use basically for gene catalogs. Then we make a preliminary evaluation before we incorporate the data into the data repository. From the repository we make a data selection. These are then the EPD source data. We run what we call the EPD assembly pipeline. The output is a list of transcription start sites or start site clusters. And then we check it in two ways, in an automatic manner, by looking at overrepresented motifs that we expect in promoters, and in a manual manner by looking at selected, randomly selected promoters in a UCSC browser window. Now this is EPD from the user's perspective. There's an FTP site. You can download the coordinates of the TSS positions. You can also download surrounding sequences, and then you can do remote analysis with your preferred software. Or you can use the web server. You can look at individual promoters via the promoter viewer, or you can analyze promoters with the accessory tools. You can either analyze the entire collection, for instance, looking at histone marks, or you can select a subset, for instance, promoters that have a bivalent chromatin structure in the embryonic stem cells, and then you can look for sequence motifs. These are the current totals, so we cover 8 species, 2 vertebrates, 3 invertebrates, 1 plant, 2 fungi. For the vertebrate species, the coverage is almost complete in terms of genes. And it's based on a large number of cage stacks. Now, this is 7 billion cage stacks. That's an impressive volume. And for the other organisms, we have not so good coverage, and so we also have lower gene coverage. For instance, for Arabidopsis, we have only 32%. Now the promoter viewer, which I mentioned already several times, it provides essential information on a single HTML page. There is text-based annotation, genome coordinates, gene symbols, and such things, hyperlinks to other resources, for instance, Swiss Regulon, mostly promoter browsers, and a picture showing the genomic context. And then there's the graphical interface, which is UCSC-based, and it shows EPD-supplied custom tracks, for instance, optimized for displaying cage data at single-base resolution. And it also presents a customized, it automatically loads a customized selection of UCSC tracks that are particularly useful when looking at promoters. So this is the text part of the EPD viewer. These are the links to the various promoter browsers. I show you in the UCSC view. So you have histone marks for the selected cell line. Then you have the single base resolution cage tag profile. Here again, it goes very high to 60,000 at the single position. Then you have selected cage tag coverage for a number of cell types. And you see that in this case, it's the MGMT promoter. This promoter is active in 2 cell lines of the selection. And in the other ones, the promoter appears to be completely silent. And you also see that there are no transcripts in the opposite orientation in this promoter. You'll notice here a CPG island. That's something useful if you look at promoters. Then you have conservation tracks and repetitive elements and SNPs. Now, this is the standard UCSC view, and you see here you have much less promoter relevant information. Now, the signal search analysis server. So this is the home page. And it's like EPD, it's an old resource. It has been, development has started in 1984. The general purpose is to discover locally overrepresented sequence motifs. Now that's kind of a strange concept. What it is, it's motifs that preferentially occur at a specific distance from a physiologically defined site in DNA or RNA sequences. And such sites may be transcription start sites, translation start sites, polyadenylation sites, or splice junctions, for instance. And there's an important difference to most other motif discovery approaches. So a locally overrepresented sequence motif is enriched at a specific distance from a functional site. The distance and the location is not known in advance. And most other programs just look at general overrepresentation within given sequences. And there's also an interesting consequence for the results, whereas standard motif discovery program returns you a motif, just a motif. The SSA programs always return you a motif plus a certain region relative to a functional site. Now, this is a graphical illustration of the concept of a locally overrepresented sequence motifs. So, these are sequences aligned on a functional site, for instance, a transcription start site. And these are the motifs, these are the occurrences of certain motifs. And you see that the red one is strongly overrepresented in the narrow region upstream of the functional site. And the green and the blue one are also overrepresented upstream, but in a larger region, maybe 100, 150 base pairs. And the enrichment is not that strong. Now, generally for all SSA programs, motifs can be defined as consensus sequences, for instance, TATAAA for a data box motif. A limited number of mismatches can be allowed. And the consensus sequence may include ambiguous codes like R for A or G. And motifs can also be uploaded as position weight matrices, also called position specific scoring matrices, which essentially such matrices consist of a table of numbers where each number relates to a particular base at a particular position in a fixed length motif. There are two numerical representations, so-called base count or base probability matrices, which indicate the frequency of a base at a particular position, and the true weight matrix, which contains additive scores that are used to compute the score for a particular sequence, which is supposed to be proportional, inversely proportional to the binding energy. This is a weight matrix on the left side and the corresponding sequence logo on the right side. It's a weight matrix which I derived for the eukaryotic data box in 1990. So we can use the program OPROF to analyze the distribution of data boxes relative to transcription start sites. What goes in is a list of genomic positions. Then the program automatically extracts DNA sequences from the genome in a certain range. The user uploads a motif, for instance, position weight matrix for the data box. Then the program identifies motif occurrences in each of the sequences and displays the distribution, the occurrence frequency of these motifs in such a type of profile. This is the input form. So EPD is directly accessible via a menu. It's at the back end of the server. It's installed at the back end of the server. You have to specify a range, a sequence range, a window width, window shift. You can select the data box motif again from a menu. You have to define a p-value. Here it's 0.01. That's the occurrence probability per genome position, it's a relatively high p-value. You can specify a background base composition, and the other inputs are not that important. And that's the result that you get. You see a nice sharp peak, but you also see that the peak is not particularly high. It reaches 10%. Now, this is a slide which I already showed you, and I just want to mention what I showed you just before is motif-based evaluation. So you see, nice peak, good promoter connection. And on the next slide, I will compare, I will do exactly the same analysis for the TSS collection extracted from ensemble and from the UCSC known gene collection. And you see, this is EPD. For ensemble, we get several peaks and they don't exceed 4%, and for UCSC, it looks slightly better. So, but overall, the conclusion is that these, compared to EPD, these collections contain many false positives, or they contain many promoters where the TSS has not been met precisely. One of the two hypotheses is true. And that's exactly the way how we optimize our procedures. If we get multiple peaks, then we work on the data selection and on the assembly pipeline, and we iterate until we are happy with the result. Now, ChIP-seq. It was developed in response to ChIP-seq data, as mentioned before. Design principles, simple tools, they should be easy to understand even for non-specialists, fast algorithms, because we don't expect computing power to increase drastically, but we do expect biological data volumes to increase drastically. And generic methods if possible, so not overly specialized for ChIP-seq data, so that they can be used for other types of data. Modularity, one program performs an elementary task, and C programs for computation, expensive procedures, glue together with Postgres. Now the web interface, the nice feature, it provides access to a large collection of public data. You can also upload your own data, you can do combined analysis, you can analyze the context of your peaks in terms of histone modifications from any code. It is interoperable with other analysis programs, for instance, the SSA server programs, and it provides direct links to send the results to other servers like the grid server. Now I will use the following example for illustration. It's data from a landmark paper. The goal was to map STAT1 binding sites. What you have to know about STAT1 is that it usually resides in the cytoplasm and thus cannot bind to DNA. Upon cytokine stimulation, it moves to the nucleus and it binds to a consensus motif approximated by TTCNNNGAA. Now, in this study, they used interferon gamma-stimulated HeLa cells and as a control, unstimulated HeLa cells. Now, this just to remind you how a ChIP-seq experiment works. So you start with chromatin, chromatin is cross-linked, then you fragmentate some method, sonication for instance, you pull down fragments that are bound by a specific protein of interest using an antibody specific for this protein, and then you sequence the fragments from the ends. Now, if everything works like illustrated here, then the sequence reads mapping to the plus end of the genome should form a cluster upstream of the binding sites, and the one mapping to the minus end should form a cluster downstream. Now, just regarding our examples, it resulted in about 15 or 13 million mapped sequence tags. Now, here you can see a two STAT1 binding site, and you can see the data. So you indeed see two peaks. The green one are the reads that map to the plus trend, the red one are the reads that map to the minus trend, and they are shifted by about 150 base pairs. Now, somewhat different from here, here the clusters do not overlap, here they do slightly. Now, taking into account this particularity of ChIP-seq data, we usually offer tag centering for the analysis. Tag centering means that you shift the tags, the tags mapping to the plus-strand downstream by about half the fragment length, and the tags mapping to the minus-strand upstream. And then you should be able to fuse the two peaks in a single one. Now, centering is offered as a standalone program, but it is rarely used. It is also offered just as a pre-processing features for all other applications. This is the centering menu. So you define, you want to use any tag, and you shift it by 75 base pairs, for instance. This is the result of centering. You see now you have a single peak which falls in between the two peaks. And if you look at this track, there is an annotated conserved stuff one by inside, which exactly coincides with this peak. So for peak detection, we offer a program called ChIP-peak. It implements a simple algorithm. It takes as input centered tags typically, and the output is a list of peak center positions. Note the difference to other peak files, which typically represent peaks by a begin and start position. We report only the center position. Now the method, very briefly, it considers only positions in the genome where there is at least one tag mapped to it. That already reduces the search space considerably. Then it evaluates the cumulative tag frequencies in a window around these positions, and it retains as peaks those windows which have a tag coverage higher than the threshold and which are maximum within a vicinity range. There is an option you can refine the peak position based on the tag distribution within the window. Now this is the interface. We can select the start one data from server menu. We define the centering, we use a window width of 300, vicinity range also of 300. And you can define the peak threshold in relative terms as relative enrichment over the average tag frequencies. And with these input parameters, you get this as output. The output page reports the number of peaks. You can download the peak list in various formats. You can directly go to the great server for analyzing GoTerm enrichment of the genes in the vicinity of the peaks. Then you can extract sequences, or you can pass the peak list to other applications for instance, on GoTerm. Now, one of the questions when you have generated the peak list is whether the peaks are true binding sites, and one way to answer this question is to look for motif enrichment. Again, we can essentially do the same as we do for promoters. If these are true peaks, then we expect the start one binding motif in the middle of the peak. Now, these are just the peak numbers that we get with different absolute tag thresholds, and obviously with a low threshold, we probably have many false positives, and if we have a high threshold, we probably miss many true positives. So I'm not going to show a detailed analysis, I'm just going to show what we get with our peak list. So we define a range about minus 500 to plus 500. Here we use a window of 100. We shift it by 5. And we use the consensus sequence TTCNNNGAA. And that's the picture we get. So it's a very beautiful OCP. Now it goes up to 30%. This is an underestimate of the true binding site, because on the one hand, STAT1 tolerates sometimes a mismatch, and we were searching the motif without mismatch. And secondly, a window of 100 does not capture the entire range where we find the motif. It's a little bit too small. So the true enrichment is more something like maybe 60-70%. Next, we could explore the genomic context of STAT1 peaks. So are they associated with certain histone marks, for instance, K27 acetylation, K4ME3, which is a promoter mark, or K27ME3, which is a repressive mark? So to answer this question, we upload the peak list to an application which is called ChIP-core, and then we choose, we look at the distribution of histone TIP-seq data which we take from ENCODE. Now basically chip core input, this is how it works, two types of genomic features. We call one reference feature, the other one target feature. For each reference feature, the program counts the number of target features in the surrounding genomic regions from position beginning to end. This region is further subdivided into windows of the size W. And then from these numbers, the program generates a so-called aggregation plot, which shows the target feature frequency as a function of the distance from the reference feature. Output is a graphic plus a file containing the numerical data, which you can download. This is just the input form. It looks similar to the other input form. Here we go for a larger region, so -5,000 to +5,000. That's one of the differences. And we use these ENCODE data, obviously for HeLa cells, because this one experiment was carried out in HeLa cells. But these are not stimulated HeLa cells. So these are not HeLa cells where STAT1 binds to target cells. Okay. This is the result we get. Now I downloaded, this is not the server output, I downloaded the text output and superposed it in this graphic. We see a strong enrichment in K27 acetylation, also pretty strong enrichment in K4ME3 in the flat profile for the repressive model. Now here's some interpretation. So we see this valley, which is kind of conspicuous. We think this indicates that the STAT1 binding sites are nucleosome free. So we have a depletion of histone tags of pertaining to histone modifications. We also, since we have a stronger K27 mark, we think it's probably STAT1 likes more enhancer regions than promoter regions. And the lack of enrichment of the repressive mark is consistent with the assumption that STAT1 is an activating transcription factor, which never represses a gene. An interesting aspect is that this is from non-stimulated cells, suggesting that the sites to which STAT1 binds are already nucleosome-free and surrounded by activating marks before STAT1 moves to the nucleus. So these histone marks somehow pre-select the region to which STAT1 can bind. Now this is just another, very briefly, another application of TIP-core. Here we give as input EPD-new. We use as target feature cage tags from an embryonic stem cell line. And then we get this profile. And on the output page, we can use a submenu which enables us to select certain reference features, promoters in this case. So we select those which have more than 10 cage tags between -50 and +50. And as a result, we get about 12,000 promoters. So these are promoters that are active at some level in embryonic stem cells. And then we can obviously go further and analyze what happens to these promoters in derived cell types and the like. Now, very briefly, the MGA repository. So it's a hierarchically structured directory. One series is one directory. The series concept is similar to the series concept in GEO. A series contains a number of data files. They may be of different types, for instance, ChIP-seq and MNN-seq. Then there are two configuration files, one that describes the series and one that describes each individual sample. And then there is also an HTML file for a user, a human readable HTML file, which provides documentation of the data. Now from these configuration files, the server automatically builds the pull-down methods. So that's how it works. But the whole archive is also accessible just by FTP, and you can download all data in a standardized format. This is the current content, so we have more than 11,000 samples in total, most of them for human, and most of them ChIP-seq, as you can see. And the large numbers here, they mostly come from the encoder, from the epigenetic roadmaps project. And, but we have other types of data. We have also DNAs, MNAs sent with DNA methylation data. We have various kinds of genome annotations. You can select splice junctions as reference features. And we have sequence-derived features like conservation scores or SNPs. It's a very rich collection. Very briefly, the PWM tools is a new package we publish of PWM-related tools. What is different to the SSA tools is, for the one hand, they use different formats, and secondly, some of the programs can use ChIP-seq, functional genomics data, and sequence data together. Now, the most useful tool is PWM-scan. The input is a whole genome, which you select from the menu, plus a motif, which you supply as a PWM or as a consensus. And the output is a complete list of all motif occurrences in the corresponding genomes. The output buttons are similar. You can pass this list to any platform, you can extract sequences around the motifs, whatsoever. Now, the method works as follows. The motif is expanded to a list of qualifying sequences. So, for instance, PWM of length 9 is expanded, is replaced by all N males that reach a score higher than the threshold. So this may be a collection of a few thousand sequences. And then we use a fast read mapping software to map these sequences to the genome. Either fetch GWI, which has been developed by Christian Nisely some time ago at SIB, or Bolton. And for longer general motifs, this approach is not effective, so we have a backup program which implements standard algorithms. And these are some performance figures. So you see that one, p-value 10 to the minus 5 is fetched GWI. It takes 1 second to retrieve all stat one occurrences in the genome. It's very fast. And for somewhat tougher cases like STAT1 at the lower threshold, or CTCF, which is a long motif of 19, at the 10 to the minus 5 threshold, and bow tie becomes more effective. See? And for very difficult cases, CTCF, a very long motif at the low p value threshold, probably a billion of qualifying sequences, then the fast read mapping approach fails. Even bow tie takes a long time, and you better use the conventional algorithm, which still returns results reasonable time. Okay, just I want to mention a few things. I think in the future we will try to extend EPD new to new model organism, maybe another plant species. Some other vertebrate species, rat, because it's very interesting to compare sequence motifs in different species. We will focus on the MJ repository. In particular, we are somewhat underpopulated with invertebrate sequences. We like to add more Drosophila data and also add more DNA methylation data. And then we make a continuous effort to improve our documentation and online tutorials. And finally, I wanted to call your attention to this upcoming event. We are giving a one-week course, introductory course to the use of our resources in April, from April 4 to April 8. Now, these are the people I have to give my thanks to. René Dreos is the man in charge of EPD, and he also is largely in charge of the data archive. Giovanna Ambrosini has developed the ChIP-seq, the SSA, and the PWM tools servers. The other group members have also contributed some pieces to the software, and they have been very helpful for quality control, user feedback, encouragement, and many other techniques. And I thank you for your attention.